for Insight with Tom Girard.
Good evening and welcome to Insight. I'm Tom Girard. And this, our last special on advertising in the 90s. We're going to take an in-depth look at a campaign which not only changed the world of advertising, but also found its way into the very fabric of modern-day society. I'm talking, of course, about the Gunnar Helin campaign. We're going to go all the way to Sweden, in the very north of Europe, and meet the men who were responsible for the campaign, as well as the ones affected by it. We'll see authentic Swedish television footage and talk to the top names in international advertising. We will uncover the whole story as told by the people who were there to experience it firsthand. Stay tuned. I'm Tom Girard with Full Insight.
It started a whole new era in advertising.
For one thing, we didn't understand the language. And two, we had no idea who the son of a bitch was. Or three, what they were trying to sell.
It was beautiful. It was completely beautiful. It was art in its purest form.
It was definitely not art.
But it was perhaps the world's greatest show. They're claiming the title from Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey's Circus here, which claimed to be the greatest show on earth. I think it may now be Shilling Yangit.
Hartelijk welkom naar de Thijs van de Leerzaal. Voor het 18e jaar gaan we ze belonen. De succesrijkste, de meest ervaren en de meest begaafde in het branche. Het is nog een keer hoog tijd voor de Gouden Eelprijs. En wie waar denk vanavond?
The Golden Eel Awards. After nearly two decades, still the most prestigious award in advertising. Gathered here, the most influential and powerful people of the trade. This was a historic occasion. The first time ever that the award was presented to a Scandinavian country.
The award for the best international campaign goes to Shilling Yangit.
Shilling-gänget, do not. Shilling-gänget, do not believe that you can compete in advertising. They say that everyone here tonight is a winner. They want to donate the Golden Eel to the Samerna, a minority people living on the Swedish-Finnish border. Thank you.
The campaign for which the Shilling Yangit won the Golden Eel was the Gunnar Helin campaign, a campaign which had nothing to sell and nothing significant to say. That such a campaign should find acceptance in the brutally commercial world of advertising is in itself astounding. That it should reach beyond that world and into the hearts of millions of citizens throughout the world is nothing short of a sensation. New York City, the very heart of the commercial world. Enthroned at their Madison Avenue offices sit the mighty kings of advertising. Dick Johnson, brand identity manager, was deeply amazed by the fact that this revolutionary campaign was non-American.
I was very influenced by it to understand that a country about which basically we don't know anything about was ingenious enough to come up with such a campaign that simply stunned the entire advertising world. I mean, took it by storm.
Sweden, a small country in the north of Europe, has for the past century been governed largely by a few wealthy families in conjunction with the Social Democratic Party. High taxes and a regulated market economy was, however, to become a recipe for disaster in the global economic reality of the 80s and 90s, and Sweden, too, had to adjust. Sweden joined the European community and opened its doors to the world. International television leaked in and inspired thousands of teenagers to work with television, advertising, and music videos. Once again, Sweden became a country to be recognized, giving rise to internationally renowned pop groups, advertisers, and music video directors.
Jonas Offerlin, the director of the video.
Art Fine, media analyst at Goldblum & Partners in New York, clearly to this day remembers the first time he was hit by Shilling Yingit's astounding campaign.
I remember very well. I was with some fellow colleagues. We were in the office. We were having a little meeting. One of the messengers brought in this tape. It was sent down by one of the vice presidents. They said, you have to see this. We put in the cassette, and I think we just kind of looked. We thought, what is this? We read the manuscript of where it came from. It came from Sweden, and we thought, I think one of the guys, he thought, what is Sweden?
Sweden, February 1996, an ordinary Thursday night with millions of Swedes anticipating the 10 o'clock news on Channel 4. Wedged in between a diaper commercial and the news of a tragic bus accident came this. The very first Relin film.
Det här är Gunnar Relin. Han var tidigare programledare för Filmkrönikan. Det är han inte längre. Han fick sparken för att han var okarismatisk och tråkig. Idag är Gunnar Relin bortglömd och ointressant.
I tell you, when I first heard about it, I saw the campaign. I wasn't sure what the hell it was about. I don't think anyone knew what it was about.
I think I was very perplexed. I didn't understand it. I didn't know what this was, but yet I had to find out.
I think the genius of it is bringing reality into a fictional world.
I mean, there was some kind of infomercial, but that's about all I could take away from it.
Well, I felt that the Gunnar was, I don't know. He, as a person, I guess didn't say anything to me. He was just this person without a personality.
Maybe I didn't think he was the greatest program leader of a film show in the world. But on the other hand, I didn't hate him either.
The films really, I think, captured something that was there and captured the nothingness that was there and made it into something.
There was a complete, pure aesthetic. It was beautiful. It was completely beautiful.
It's totally laughable. There's nothing revolutionary here. It's been done to death for years.
The more I searched, the more I looked into it, I found nothing, but yet I wanted more.
But even the Swedish audiences were not quite ready for this new form of advertising. It was shown on television and at movie theaters across the country, but only a handful of people took notice. The public at large felt confused, or perhaps just indifferent.
When the Shilling Gänget started his campaign, he had already stopped being a TV personality. And that was one of the interesting things about this campaign.
Hej och välkomna till en filmkrönika som idag bland annat handlar om Danmark, där en ny regissör...
Gunnar Relin rose to national stardom as the Gene Siskel of Swedish television. A veteran film critic who for a while hosted the legendary Film Chronicon, Sweden's longest-running movie review. His style was serious and low-key, a contrast to the commercial network's cheerful and superficial movie coverage. He was, as the first film pointed out, perceived by some as quite dull. But by the time the film was aired, Gunnar Relin was out of the limelight and all but forgotten. With Shilling Yingit's second film, he once again rocketed into the national consciousness.
år sedan var Gunnar Elin programledare för Filmkrönikan. Men han fick sparken för att han var okarismatisk och tråkig. Sedan dess har Gunnar inte haft sex. Inte för att han inte velat, utan för att hans fru inte släppt till.
Art doesn't need words or language to be expressed properly, and it can be interpreted by whoever sees it in whatever way they'd like to see it. In advertising, you can't let the person who looks at it react in any way they'd like to. You want them to react in a specific way.
Jesus.
The second film was somewhat harsher, and the audience began to take notice.
Gunnar Elin-kampanjen har slagit rot.
This is what I feel about the Swedish audience. They recognize their genius. It took them a while, just as it took us a while, but they recognize their genius.
I think the fact that the Swedish advertising history is much more recent than American has certainly worked to the Swedes' advantage.
Ah, but the Swedish audience is so much more sophisticated than the American audience, is that they like the sagas, they like the stories, they like being entertained. They will go out and buy the product anyway, and all that you have to do is show the product at the end, and they will immediately link the product with this great story. It's just so wonderful to see the creative people being able to be creative and not being tied into just a corner of selling a product and nothing but the product.
Kalk för benstommen och
protein.
In social democratic Sweden, advertising has always had an ugly ring to it. The idea of selling a product is at odds with their toothless brand of capitalism. So rather than going for the hard sell, Swedes have specialized in selling by means of corniness and silliness. The heroes of the advertising world being not macho hunks and sexy babes, but goofy nerds and laughable oddballs. This wimp factor has given the Swedes their own unique brand of advertising, where commercials have been geared to entertain rather than persuade by use of image. Giving sexual stereotypes an ironic twist and poking fun at the very idea of advertising itself, Swedish advertisers have still not come to terms with the fact that, although they may appear to be free and anarchistic, they are still at the service of the commercial world.
Here you have a bunch of comedians, drifters, I would say. And they bring a whole new concept to my business, which I have, I went to school for this for several years, and I've been several years within it.
What they created was something that nobody could really touch, but it just created this global impact. It was art in its purest form.
It was definitely not art. Actually, if you think about it, it was quite childish, actually. Kid stuff.
What is art, anyways? I mean, art is life. All of life is art, and advertising is part of life, so advertising is art. I mean, it's obvious.
The Shillingya is, when you look back on it, never really had a childhood. They went straight into acting. So I think if you really look back on it, that they were trying to create something that we all want and need, a proper childhood.
Shillingjänget had started their career in vaudeville, touring the country, performing at campuses and open-air festivals to mostly indifferent audiences. They then proceeded to make a name for themselves in radio. In the early 90s, they went into television and were the first to capitalize on the new fad of using irony and humor. In that style, they created a long line of immensely popular TV series, which would put them into the hearts of millions. Among them were In the Ring with Glenn Schilling, Nila City 105.6, and The Tears of Percy. By the late 1990s, they had retired to a mansion in the south of Sweden. It was widely thought that they had retired from show business altogether.
probably didn't know what to do with their lives. I think so they started doing things that you can compare to Elvis, things that just didn't make sense. I think that's what happened to them.
This is the Schillinge Hus in the south of Sweden, where the Schillinge Gänget wrote and edited the award-winning Gunnar Wallin campaign. For the past 4 years, it's also been their home, in addition to being their dog-breeding genetic laboratory. Together, they've been living here with a chef, a maid, and 4 male servants. Reportedly, they take long walks together, but they rarely leave the premise that's located behind this iron gate.
I thought, how could they do this to this harmless middle-aged has-been? I mean, it was just so cruel.
I'm quite sure that if Gunnar would just have stayed down and just tried to cool it and lay low for a while, the whole thing would have blown over. But I don't know. I guess that he wanted to defend himself in some way, so he held this press conference.
Hej och välkommen till presskonferensen. Jag heter Jan Erik och är Gunnars ombud.
I would imagine if you hire somebody who is not the worst, not the best, but in the middle, who cares? But the fact that he hired the worst person, that's publicity in itself.
Här har vi lite material.
There's the David and Goliath story right there. You have this Schillinge-gänget, they're against the worst PR person, and Gunnar Wallin, and they're battling it out. And that's beautiful, I think. I think he created his own media hype right there.
Birgitta kommer från
Dagens Nyheter.
Oj, hälsa Jocke Werner.
Var befinner sig Gunnar just nu, idag?
Han är på hemlig ort.
Jaha. Vi på TV4 skulle vilja ha en liten personlig intervju.
Ni får inte börja pressa Gunnar nu. Han är väldigt labil för tillfället. Allting måste gå igenom mig. Men jag kan säga så här. För TV4 finns det alltid plats. Gunnar, han är med oss på telefon här, så ni kan få höra vad han har att säga.
Ja, det är Wallin.
Hallå?
Wallin här, Gunnar Wallin.
Är Gunnar?
Hallå?
Hej Gunnar.
Jan Erik.
Ja, vi ska inte störa här för länge, men... Jaha, nu är det någon som har någon telefon som ringer. Ja. Privat så kan ju vara väldigt uppsluppen och rolig, eller hur?
Ja. Svaret är ja.
Fick ni med det? Den här frågan är lite privat, jag vet det, men... Visst har du haft sex de senaste 2 åren?
Ja, flera gånger.
Flera gånger har Gunnar haft sex de senaste 2 åren. Fick ni med det?
Ja, är det sex med frun det gäller, eller?
Jan-Erik.
Är du utanför familjen?
Han har haft sex de senaste 2 åren, men vi kan ju inte gå, kan inte skriva med vem. Gunnar är jätteläcker. Han har alltid haft en massa tjejer runt omkring sig. Han är karismatisk. Han har haft sex de senaste 2 åren. Några frågor?
Hallå.
To an excited world press at the Old Stock Exchange in Stockholm 2 days later, Schillinge-gänget made their first public statement regarding the matter.
Ja, hjärtligt välkomna. Schillinge-gänget viker inte en tum. Gunnar Wallin har inte haft sex de senaste 2 åren. Han hade inte särskilt mycket sex innan dess heller.
Vad har du för källa?
Det är dessutom troligt att han inte kommer att ha sex mer överhuvudtaget.
Men var Schillinge-gänget emot Gunnar Wallin?
Är det typ en påhopp eller?
Absolut inte, nej då. Schillinge-gänget håller redan på att planera nästa steg i kampanjen.
Är de inte oroliga för de rättsliga följderna?
Och tackar jag för uppmärksamheten. Hej, så långt.
The campaign had an enormous impact.
Gunnar, mördare!
Gunnar, mördare!
Ja, här har man köpt ett hus i ett lugnt område och sen blir det på det här viset. Det är inte bra.
Men vad vet ni om de här anklagelserna? Vet ni att de är sanna?
Nej, vet vi inte. Men det är ju så här att med alla de här olika typerna av anklagelser man utgår från att det ligger sanning någonstans i dem. Sen hur mycket, det vet man inte. Det är ju bara så.
Ja, vi ska döda om han kommer ut. Han ska inte vara här. Torr gubbe alltihopa här. Titta här på bilen han har här. Va? Han har inte bilen i garage utan han har porr där inne. Och tack på våra barn.
Så vi vill inte ha honom här i området.
Vid ett par tillfällen har ju Lisa kommit hem väldigt sent. När hon har gått från dagmamman som är här nere.
Men vad har det med Gunnar Ulin att göra?
Jo, det har att göra med, man har ju hört vad han gör med mot barna. Det har man ju hört.
Det händer ju ingenting. Man ringer polisen, man går andra politiska vägar och ingenting händer.
Vi kan för fan inte sova på nätterna här. Det är en jävla lök. Han ska ut.
By this time Gunnar had gone into hiding and the only one talking was his agent.
Vad är det för jävla kul med det här? Ta några billiga poäng på Gunnars bekostnad. Vad är det för kul med? Vilka tror de här chillinggänget att de är egentligen? Här kan ni. Gunnar! 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 Gunnar!
Gunnar! Gunnar! Det blev bara som talar! För helvete!
The atmosphere became more spiteful and charged for each day that passed. But there were yet more accusations to come.
Varje år begås 7500 inbrott enbart i Mälardalsområdet. Antalet brott ökar år för år och Gunnar Elin är en av inbrottstjuvarna. Gunnar Elin, han stjäl.
Well, obviously a lot of people believed in the propaganda, as I would call it, and they thought that he were a thief and you know, a child molester
and during the campaign, I mean, nobody would have touched him. You could have run over him by a car and no one would have helped him.
He was just like cancer.
Well, I think that people wanted him to disappear and just vanish from the face of the earth, and that was actually what he did.
It was not only Shilling Yangit who had isolated themselves from the outside world. Gunnar Elin, too, took refuge in the comfortable surroundings of his own home. Speaking only to a few select friends, he tried to get on with his life and put the whole ordeal behind him. At Scandinavia's largest newspaper, Aftonbladet, the Evening Blade, we met Jan-Olof Andersson, fellow film critic and close friend of Gunnar Elin.
Well, we're not really friends exactly, but I called him a couple of times, yeah. He was coping. He was trying to cope. He had a lot of time to do things he didn't do otherwise. I guess he had a lot of spare time.
Loneliness was taking its toll on Gunnar. His behavior was becoming increasingly strange and erratic.
Jag gick över här och han kom ut och vi gick ut och ja, jag tror vi stod ganska exakt här. Ja, ganska exakt här. Och jag ville låna hink. Och så började han berätta att han hade gjort ett armborst. Vadå armborst? Ett armborst? Jaha, ett vapen som fungerar så. Kan man skjuta med det då? Nej, nej, det är gjort av kött. Kött, jaha, kött. Griskött då. Jaha, jaha, så. Ja, kan man få låna här? Du kan ju äta upp det, så jag lite. Nej, nej, det går inte, sa han. Det går inte. Och han betedde sig väldigt underligt då. Då kände jag att det är djupt. Det här sitter djupt. Det är en dubbelnatur. Han är en dubbelnatur och när man inser det då, att man har bott tillsammans så nära varandra, då blir man kall, skakig.
You know, maybe the guy didn't deserve all the lousy treatment that he got from the films, but hey, they were good films. What can I say?
They knew they had a very cynical public to sell to. They knew they could get away with a certain amount of silliness. And they used the right formula at the right time.
They planned every progression for every film. They wanted to see this reaction, and then the next film they wanted this reaction all the way to the end, because eventually there has to be an end. And they knew exactly how to end it.
Det fanns fram till nyligen ett litet folkslag i Afrika, ett självförsörjande folk som levde fredligt i samklang med naturen och aldrig gjorde en fluga för när. Men det tyckte inte Gunnar Elin. Han ville inte bara se folkslaget utrotat. Han åkte dit själv och såg till att det blev utfört på effektivast möjliga sätt.
That shook me up a bit.
After the genocide film, there was definitely a change of tide and in momentum.
The whole thing sort of just blew up way out of proportion.
Yes, it was highly immoral. But I don't think morality has anything to do with it.
Everybody has anger in them. Everybody has hate, or they have jealousy.
Then we knew it was time to get off that train, because then it had gone beyond the bounds of decency.
To completely wipe out a whole tribe of people in Africa, I mean, it's just a bit too far-fetched, wasn't it?
It could be disgusting, gross, everything, but you still watch it.
It's like going past, driving past a car accident, and you stop, and you watch it, and it horrifies you, but you keep watching it. You're somehow drawn into it.
The genocide film came to have an enormous and immediate impact on the world of advertising, producing instant copycats like the Canon Judah Bauer campaign. Judah Bauer was the guitar player in a second division American neo-blues band, the John Spencer Blues Explosion. Canon used his name and likeness in a series of advertisements, depicting him as an environmental villain.
I suppose we could go farther than that, but it's hard to imagine what.
The more cynical the market, the more you dig down to come up and use your fantasy. I believe that the true test of advertising is to be able to sell anything to a most cynical public.
Really? They've already shown us that there are no limits, that anything goes these days.
Soon, the target of the smear campaigns became less important. All that was left was the aggression and the pitch, of course.
Ah, Amosa.
In Japan, this was taken to greater lengths than anywhere else, discarding both the villain and the product. All that was left now was unfocused anger.
You had to empathize with Rolin, and somehow were won over to his side in spite of all the cleverness that Chilling Yang had put forward prior.
The impact of the genocide film made Rolin launch a counterattack, much smaller in budget and much gentler in tone. It couldn't quite compete with the films of Chilling Yang.
Gunnar är inte alls dum, och han har inte utrotat något folkslag skulle det vara.
You somehow developed an empathy for Rolin that didn't exist before.
Obviously he worked with the completely incompetent personnel.
I think he is a complete nothing.
I mean, they wanted to see him get his revenge somehow. And so they were willing to believe these films, even though they weren't nearly as professionally done as the other ones from the Killing Gang.
Gunnar was totally heartbroken after this campaign. Why, Jan-Erik said to me, why do they want to hurt me?
Come with me. I have my room.
Gunnar Ahlin's PR manager, Jan-Erik Svardfeld, was heavily criticized for the first counter film, although not without certain naivistic charm. It was far too lame to neutralize the impact of the genocide film.
Yes, but we said from the beginning, we shall not sink to the Killing Gang's low level. No, but in the end, we didn't have a choice. We have to give back with the same coin. And remember, they were the ones who started. They were the ones.
Although aggression did not come easily to the Rahlin team, they were well aware of Shilling Yangit's weaknesses and did their best to target them.
Killinggänget. De har aldrig med några kvinnor i sina serier. De vägrar ta ställning. Dessutom är de inte speciellt roliga överhuvudtaget.
There were never any women in their comedy. And it was widely assumed that Killinggänget were gay and living in a gay community in this house. And
rumors that funny things were going on there.
Yeah, I don't know, maybe they're gay. Isn't everybody in advertising?
Well, I've heard those rumors about Gunnar Ahlin being a homosexual, but I hadn't heard it about Killinggänget yet. I'd be very surprised to see how that turned out.
Rumors about Killinggänget were now flourishing even among Rahlin's detractors, their former fans.
Vad jag vet så får ju knappt ett fruntimme komma över tröskeln där, va? Det verkar ju, tycker jag personligen. Men jag vet ingenting om det, men bögbeteende är ju bögbeteende, va, liksom.
Killinggänget seemed to panic and reacted by sending human excrements to Gunnar Ahlin in a regular 9x12 envelope.
Det är förskräckligt. Att skicka bajs på posten. Tänk om några barn skulle få tag i det.
Ja, det var kul till en början när de sa att han var tråkig och okarismatisk. Men att skicka bajs, det är väl att gå för långt.
Ja, och skattebetalarna och allt. Det är jag som betalar skatt och tv-licens. Och de är idioter. Att behandla en människa sådär. Att bo och stuga och allting. De är för fan perversa människor. Det är min mening. Punkt och slut. Ha så bra. Hej då.
Ulf Schenkmanis torkar sig framifrån.
The magic was gone.
I Strängnäs är alla invånare homosexuella.
To equal their initial success would be just about impossible to do. To come very close to it would be quite desirable. And I would say they came close to it. But to equal it, I don't think they made that.
Denna man har vanlig lön. Han arbetar åt någon annan.
Och jag tycker att Killinggänget borde ta och se sig själva i spegeln och fråga sig själva vad de håller på med.
In a last ditch attempt to reconnect with the masses, Killinggänget decided to put the negativity behind them and to instead glorify themselves. Surprise. is generally regarded as the cornerstone of all comedy. Having surprised their audiences to the point of confusion, Shilling Yingit's biggest surprise was yet to come. In the spring of 1998, Shilling Yingit stunned the media world by inviting journalists to an exclusive press conference inside the iron gates of Shillinghus, which up till then had been strictly off limits to anyone outside Shilling Yingit's inner circle.
Hjärtligt välkomna till denna presskonferens. Det är alltså vi här som är Killinggänget. Jag heter Jonas och ja, det är jättekul att så många kunde komma. Ja, Johan, du kanske kan
okay.
Ta över det här.
Ja visst, vi kan ju lyfta på det här så länge så vi ser vad vi har. All right. Ja, så här ligger det till. Vi har lagt huvud bakom oss. Ja, och så har vi tänkt att satsa lite grann på must istället. Väldigt god must, om jag får säga det själv. Vi brygger den själva här. Varför på Killingehus i vårt eget musteri.
Varför har ni gett er på Gunnar Elin?
Ja, det kommer att finnas påskmust, julmust och så kommer vi faktiskt att göra en allroundmust som vi säljer resten av.
Varför har ni gett er på Gunnar Elin?
Vi är intresserade att höra vad alla har att säga.
Humor skapas ju inte i ett vakuum. Men en god must skapas i en tunna.
Ja, det finns alltså must här i påsar, 6 stycken i varje påse. Så har vi pressmaterial här om ni vill kanske
öppna.
It's a must, brukar vi säga.
Här är pressmaterial. Kommer någon elaka
här i förmiddagen, tycker jag. Jag är nästan
råkig. Although they claimed it had been a lifetime hobby, Shilling Yingit's lemonade was still perceived by most as a means of diversion. But just as clearly as Shilling Yingit's grip on their audience was slipping, Relin was heading for glory.
I mean, that in our day and age, every celebrity gets a second chance, no matter what he's done.
Absolutely. With a touch of genius, talent, and beauty.
It's kind of like they sing in that song, you know, if Adolf Hitler flew in today, they'd send a limousine anyway.
It was absolutely lovely, is that it was great seeing him return, is that here was a person that had been absolutely vilified on Swedish TV, and here he was back at the top of the form. You could see the glow in his face, you could see the happiness that it had, you could see basically just his ability to use public relations correctly. It was just very good use of advertising, it was good use of public relations, it was a good use of his personality, it was a good use of his prior experience as a movie critic, it was a prior good use of his respect that he had within the industry, and it was always nice to see sort of the underdog triumph over basically the advertising campaign that had been directed against him. But it was a tremendous comeback, and comeback he did, and what a tremendous comeback he had.
Det här är Gunnar Elin. För 3 år sedan fick han sparken från Filmkrönikan för att han ansågs vara okarismatisk och tråkig. Att bli arbetslös hör till det mest nedbrytande som en människa kan råka ut för. Men för Gunnar Elins del tog inte förmjukelsen slut där. I 2 års tid utsattes han för en systematisk och hänsynslös förtalskampanj som nära nog kom att krossa honom totalt. Hur skulle ni själva känna om hela samhället plötsligt vände sig emot er? Om ni plötsligt blev angripen av folk som ni inte känner, om även era vänner, föräldrar och barn inte längre orkade kännas vid det? Hur tror ni att det känns att hamna i en sån negativ spiral? Gunnar Elin var många gånger nära att ge upp, men det gjorde han inte. Han vill be alla er som rycktes med av den här förfärliga historien att ställa er följande frågor. Vad hände med kärleken? Vad hände med omtanken, medmänskligheten och den vanliga, sunda anständigheten? Låt inte Gunnar Elins lidande ha varit förgäves. Ta reda på så mycket ni kan om en människa innan ni dömer henne. Låt oss gemensamt tvätta bort vår kollektiva skam.
Låt oss alla få tillbaka vår värdighet genom att låta Gunnar Relin återfå sin. Låt hans namn än en gång bli synonymt med kvalitet och anspråkslöshet inom filmkritiken.
Mozart and Salieri, I think. Someone who's completely nothing winning over a genius.
We can take advantage of the audience, or we can project things that we want them to see, not necessarily what is good for them to see, but we play on their weakness, because their weakness is what stirs their excitement.
It would have been better without them, or with them. Because I thought they destroyed some of our reputation here in Sweden.
When you can see it and when you understand it, you're not harmed by it anymore. And I think that everybody working in media is not harmed by media. So I can't really tell if Gunnar was harmed by this campaign or if it just was a PR trick from his side either.
They created him. They made him a star. He was nothing before that.
It is show business. We deliver bits of information, but it's how we want to do it. And that's my job, is to make sure that I deliver the best information for my clients.
It certainly is a good example of the way the culture is reacting in that decade. It shows us what our goals are, what our preferences are, what the fashion styles are of the day. So from that standpoint, it is a very accurate commentary of the culture of the day, but by no means does it cross the line into art.
Well, the audience really can't be regarded as a loser either, because it was great advertising. They saw the media at its absolute height. They saw basically a great comedy group. They saw someone with an even better comeback. They saw basically the ability of the media to really represent the best in what is human society, the ability to glamorize, the ability to bring to the forefront what people feel, what people deal with. This is human nature, and it's all on TV now.
Shilling Yingit's Lemonade will be introduced on the American market later in the year. Next week, is Saatchi & Saatchi losing their grip on Procter & Gamble? And are small independent agencies taking over? Is this the end of the Jurassic era? Until then, I'm Tom Girard with Full Insight.
Got him.